You can use the same sleeves the best players in the world use, Channel Fireball sleeves. And what better way to carry them than in a Channel Fireball deck box? And if you want to play like the best, you have to dress like the best. Channel Fireball shirts, hats, hoodies, and more are all available in the apparel section of ChannelFireball.com. Head to ChannelFireball.com/store to find all of your gaming supplies.
Alright. Welcome to the Theros Drafts. Look what we have here. Ember Swallower. This guy's pretty good. Very large, in charge, definitely difficult to block, and he becomes even larger when you have a lot of mana. And then, as a result of that, everyone has a little bit less mana. Yeah, that's probably what we're going to take, so we're just going to go ahead and highlight him right there. Other good cards in the pack include Nimbus Naiad, which is quite good. Basically, turns all your sort of non-threatening creatures into large threatening flyers that bash your opponent's brains in. Those are basically the two cards that I like. Other cards are fairly mediocre, like Last Breath is pretty mediocre. So yep, we're just gonna go ahead and take our Ember Swallower and be happy. And looking at this pack, we have an Erebos's Emissary. We have Lash of the Whip. There's also Voyage's End. Best card in the pack, I would say, is not Lash of the Whip, for sure. It's between Erebos's Emissary and Voyage's End. And this is pretty close, I think. Erebos's Emissary definitely adds a lot of complexity to the game because it's difficult to evaluate at times what your opponent has in their hand. You can sort of guess here and there, but much of the time it's going to be difficult to say how many creatures they have out of a, like, if they have four cards in their hand, they may have two creatures, they may have one creature, and they have four or three. And as such, it's difficult to block anything regarding this guy. One option for Voyage's End is if we take the Voyage's End, then we pass a bunch of black cards, but I think the Erebos's Emissary is just a little better. Yuck. Wow, this pack is pretty bad. There is a, well, in terms of drafting red or black, there is a Nemesis Immortals, and that's going to be the best card in the pack by a fair margin. So, looking at the other cards, there's some black cards, not much red, so we may end up losing our Ember Swallower, unfortunately. But yeah, there's nothing that really compares to Nemesis, so we're going to go ahead and take that. And right off the bat, we're starting off with a nice little Jund deck. All we need are a few Voyaging Satyrs to smooth things out. And as you can see here, it appears that red is being drafted. And we're left with the options of Sip of Hemlock versus Time to Feed. And this is actually kind of close also. Time to Feed is generally cheaper than this slow guy. This deals with a creature, even if we don't have one out, so I'm more inclined to take that. And that'll make let us hopefully wield Hunt the Hunter or Shredding Winds, assuming that we end up in green-black. I don't like filling my deck with a lot of expensive cards. There's also Dragon Mantle, but I think we're going to end up passing on that. It just feels like red is not being, it will not be available in this pack. So we'll take the sip. Tasty. Okie dokie. So what do we have here? We have Warrior's Lesson, which is basically opportunity. Oh, wait, no, it's not. There's Cutthroat Maneuver, which is pretty expensive. Definitely adds a bit of complexity to the board. Or during combat, rather. But I don't really like my tricks to cost a ton of mana. So I'm going to go ahead and take Burnished Heart. Why? Because we probably have what is going to turn out to be an expensive deck, and by taking this guy, we make it so that it's more likely that one of these guys wields. Hopefully it's this guy, because I'm a fan of him. Anytime I can play a 3-5s or 5, I'll do it. Aspiring to my heroes. Yep, so I guess we can take this as an obvious sign that green is open. We'll happily go into it. Moo. And take the Karametra's Acolyte, or Karametra's, because this guy is pretty sweet. I don't know how many of you have done this before, but one time when this guy was in play, I played an Arbor Colossus, activated its monstrosity, and played another creature. It may have been one of these. This guy can definitely do some absurd things. And when you're jumping from 4 to 6 mana, you'll be happy to have this guy in your deck. Now here, we can take either Traveler's Amulet or Ill-Tempered Cyclops. Taking the Cyclops hedges on red ending up as in a color that we go into, whereas Traveler's Amulet is going to be fairly mediocre in the sense that we're probably not going to be splashing. But if we do splash, then we already have the Burnished Heart. Since we're playing green, we also have access to some other cards that non-green doesn't have. This pack is fairly mediocre. There's an Anvil Rot Raptor. There's also a Centaur Battlemaster. And I'm going to take the Battlemaster because the Raptor is fairly unimpressive. Whereas the Battlemaster can be okay depending on how many bestow creatures you have or combat tricks like Time to Feed. And plus, passing this guy is going to be less of a signal for the guy to R. It's going to make green more available in the next pack. And so this time I'm going to take Agent of Horizon simply because it's a 3-2 for 3 mana. It's not quite Nessian Courser. And at this point it does not appear like we'll be able to activate the unblockable ability, but you never know. It is a chance. I'm not a fan of the Satyr Piper just because it's very expensive, pretty small, and doesn't really help in the way that Agent of Horizon does. So there's that. And this pack has nothing, so we can take a Peak Eruption. Or something else. Maybe a Benthic Giant. That's probably the best card. But we want to make sure that the person in on our left is in blue, and giving him more playables. So we'll go ahead and take that. Now we can take a Fleshmount Steed or a Bogarden. Hellkite not included. This is pretty close. I generally am a fan of Bogarden Hellkite. And so right now we just have a Sip of Hemlock and an Ouroboros' Emissary, so I can definitely see potentially playing this, whereas I would prefer not to play Fleshmount Steed. It is just not an exciting magic card. And we can take Hunt the Hunter as a sideboard option. It'll be pretty awesome. And now we get an Asphodel Wanderer that is going to be unplayable, pretty much. So this pack was okay. It wasn't that exciting. Not really happy with ending up in three solid colors, although we don't really have that much red comparatively. Black, we also don't have that much, but we have more playables that are closer to the middle level. Ooh, Thassa. What is this guy worth? I gotta check. Hold on. Well, that's gonna be make someone happy to our right. We are gonna take Nessian Asp. Why? Because it's quite a large creature, and large creatures are fun to play with. And that's about all that I want to take out of this pack. So, yep, Nessian Asp it is. Look at that. This pack is not as interesting as the last one. There's a Disciple of Phoenix, the Rage of Purphoros. At this point, it's unclear whether or not we want to be in black or red, but I would assuming that red ends up being more highly drafted, we should be in black. Although green-black is not the best color combination, so kind of stuck in a spot here. There's the Unknown Shores, and that would let us activate our Agent of Horizons. That's very terrible though. So I'm gonna go ahead and take this Disciple. It's not the best, certainly. Or we can take Read the Bones. I don't really care for either at this point. Yeah, this card is just not very interesting. So we'll just take the Disciple. I don't really want to play red. And we have a Time to Feed. And there's an Ordeal of Nylea, but in a deck full of four drops, Ordeals are not very good, so we'll go ahead and take the Time to Feed, especially since we have Centaur Battlemaster. That is quite tasty. Nom 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 nom. This pack has got some stuff. Best card is a Mogis's Marauder. Unfortunately, this doesn't fit well in our deck because we're probably going to be winning the late in the late game, and so something like Agent of Horizons is going to function better simply because we have I think we're going to be green based, and it's 3 power, something that we can just play out. And so it just seems like it's going to end up working out a little bit better for us. The other option would be to take a Fade into Antiquity or a Savage Surge as a sideboard option, though I would consider playing Fade main. I don't really like playing it as a, playing sorcery removal in this case. I would much rather have Artisan Sorrow just because it really messes up combat. So we're going to take this Agent Horizons. And here we can take a Leaf Crown Dryad. Why? Because this guy is pretty good at defending against flyers. Also, it makes guys more makes guys pretty large and in charge, whereas the centaurs are sort of mediocre in the sense that they are only good on turn 5 and not on turn 2 if you want to block. So we'll snatch that up just like that. And we're gonna hide this Asphodel Wanderer, hide this Ember Swallower, hide this Ill-Tempered Cyclops at the moment. It's not clear that we're, I mean, I would, right now we can take this guy, Loathsome Beast, or Catabolopus, yeah, I just can't pronounce this at all. There's also Marshal of the Turn, but I prefer to take a Savage Gorilla, as it were, or Pitchburn Devils, I guess that's a better description. You can force people to block it, and all that nonsense. Now, we've got Vulpine Goliath or Centaur Courser. I'm more of a fan of Centaur Courser because I don't really want to overload my deck with a lot of expensive cards. And Centaur Courser is just upgrading this guy, so I'm more of a fan of that. Now we have Rescue from the Underworld, which is not that great generally when your creatures are all large. So we can just take another one of these guys, which makes things a little bit trickier, I guess. Alternatively, there's this thing, but at the moment, I think we're gonna probably gonna have more black in the next pack, so we'll just go ahead and start snatching up black cards. Now, here we can take a Viper's Kiss over the Hedonist, sideboard a Dark Betrayal. Well, there's this Rage of Purphoros, is it still here? Apparently no one's drafting red directly to our, other than the person who's passing to us that was taking red. There's no one else drafting red, which, yeah, whatever. But Dark Betrayal is a good sideboard card, so we're going to take that. And I guess we can just take this guy since it's large, and the rest of the pack is junk. So yeah, this pack is pretty mediocre. I guess it wasn't that mediocre. I mean, we got a few good green cards. We got the Nessian Asp. We got the Leaf Crown Dryad. We got a Time to Feed, which is okay. Overall, it was pretty unexciting compared to what I was hoping for. Really wanted to open a mythic that would have been good in our colors. Is that too much to ask? Yeah, we'll just take that. But yeah, next pack I can hope that we end up seeing a lot of green and black stuff. Preferably green, unless they're broken black cards. But yeah, I'm not really too happy with how this draft is playing out so far, because green-black is not the best color combination. And here we go, March of the Return, yay! More late game. And there we go, a forest to put in our deck immediately. All right, so here's to opening a good pack 3. Ready? Drum roll, please.